gave him that authority?
Your king. Because that's where the bank charters come from. Okay? Are you understanding me? This authority is bogus. Yes, it's legitimate. But it's legitimate, but it's a legitimate illegitimacy. Okay? It's not. So the king has granted a charter for Dr. So-and-so to create a bank to control my money, your money. So you cannot take this money because they are loaning out 9 times more money than you have put in. So if everyone goes to get their money, it's not there. Why isn't it there? Because they've loaned it to all of these people who are making projects that they don't intend to complete. They just want the cash. It's your cash. They're putting it into their pocket, then they're going up to Genting Highland to gamble. You see, all these big doctos and doctooks and dimwits. That's what they are. That's what the D really stands for. So, this system is backwards. Backdoor. It's backwards. It's not just backdoor, it's backwards. We're rolling out the red carpet for people who are thieving from you, stealing from you, on a moment-to-moment basis. And you're treating them with honor. This is not Islam. This is not the heart of a person who says that they are enslaved to Allah. You are enslaved to the legitimate illegitimacy. If you just go along with the system and don't speak out against it, yes, we cannot change it. We do not have the power to change it, but we can speak out against it. And who's speaking out against it? Very, very few people. Why? Because they are afraid. They're afraid of that crusader's sword. That's what they're afraid of. They're afraid of the ISA. They're afraid of all of these things. And that's why these bankers can get away with it. And they can build their mansion here, another one there, another one there. And so-and-so can steal $600 million and then get the more tax dollars to pay for it and then go and write a letter to the Prime Minister of Israel to get more money. Because his own people have spent all the money that they stole from their own people. They need to keep the fundamentalists who are going to speak against their wickedness. They need to keep them under control. Under control how? Under the control of the crusader's sword. Because in that letter, you see, said also, you have unlimited access to our military bases if you give us the money. Did you catch that? Maybe you didn't. You see, all of this is part of the backdoor Riva system. It's very, very wicked. It's the height of hypocrisy. And for people to be in that position and then to take the position, this is an Islamic nation. Yeah, please. Who are they kidding? Are they trying to fool God? Because they haven't fooled me. They haven't fooled this man. And maybe for a time they fooled some of you. I hope we've answered your question, young man.
I forgot to mention, we have the importance of the prohibition of riba. A book of mine, which has been out of print for some years now, we managed to reprint it, but not in English, in Bahasa. I got it from the print readers 2 days ago. We have it there. We have the gold dinar and silver dirham Islam and the future of money, which also explains the subject. We have it both in English and Bahasa. And finally, we have the prohibition of riba in the Quran and Sunnah. is a bigger book, which is also there to help you with the subject of riba.
Next question.
Assalamu alaikum. There are a number of movements in Malaysia to promote dinar and dirham. One very active group, very prominent group, charges extremely high amounts for dinars and dirham, quite significantly above normal prices. And also these coins have some spring symbols on them, which maybe Dr. Omar would be very interested in seeing. I put my point to these people that by charging such a high price for this currency which ordinary Muslims should be using, they are actually deterring Muslims from taking up Islamic currency. The replies I got were very hostile. I'm just wondering, really, is it permissible to make profit on dinars and dirhams if your objective is to energize the Ummah to go back to an Islamic currency?
Let me first make my comment and then Dr. Omar, thank you. Islam gives the world a free and a fair market. A free market is a market in which there are no price controls. Around the world today, in every single Muslim country, as well as others, you have now price controls everywhere. Because of the riba economy, you now have minimum wage legislation, for example. In addition to which, in Malaysia, when you buy a cup of teh tarik, is it correct that the price is controlled by the government? Is it correct?
Sugar.
Sugar is controlled by the government? Is the price control of sugar? So, this is a violation. The market in Islam is a free and a fair market. Nowhere in the world today is a free and a fair market exist. Nowhere in the world today. And this is particularly so in the price of commodities. The price of commodities is controlled in what is known as the commodity market. The commodity markets are always located
in England, in a special square mile of England, of London.
You have the gold market. And if you believe that the price of gold is free, and the market determines the price of gold, and if you believe that the market determines the price of silver, and the market determines the price of wheat and of rice and of barley and these things, I suggest you buy a one-way ticket to the moon. Because no, nothing is free anymore. It's not a free market anymore. It's all controlled. They fix the price. They fix the price. So our first problem, when we mint dinar and dirham, is to sell the dinar and dirham for paper money. That's the first problem. Because the price in paper money is fixed. If, however, and this is not my field of expertise, this is the field of expertise of other scholars, if, however, we could return to our monetary system, where the price of gold is determined by weight comparison with wheat and barley and dates and salt and so on, that one item probably knows more of the subject than I do, which is sitting at the back there, that you will get the value of this much of silver based on the corresponding weight of barley.
then you will be able to determine the true price of silver,
of your silver coin.
And then you will be able to fix the price, not fix the price, establish the market price. We have to try to solve this problem. We who are now in the market of minting dinar or dirham and offering them up for sale, then we will set the price, we will establish the market price, not on the basis of something determined in the commodity market in London.
No,
we are not going to follow your violation of the free and fair market by fixing a price. But we are going to go back to our original monetary system and get the value of this silver coin based on its equivalent in commodities like barley and wheat and so on. That is the root answer to your question. In the meantime, however, there is the other part of the subject. This is the price that they have fixed in London for silver. The Zionists, they fixed this price for silver. You're buying it at this price and you're selling it for us at this exorbitant price. That's wrong. You should not be doing that. The consumer should compare prices of those who are selling dinar and dirham to be able to establish what is a fair price based on paper money, and those who are charging too much, you don't buy from them. That's the way you buy in the market. Everybody is selling their tomatoes for 2 ringgits and he's selling for 5. Simple way to solve the problem, don't buy from him.
This is a complicated issue, right? I agree with the Sheikh, there is no such thing as a free market now, and especially in Israel. But when you have people coming in to the Ummah and expressing the ideals of the Ummah, which are embraced by the Sunnah, and then they counteract those ideals by charging an exorbitant price over and above whatever the market rate might be, you'll have to question, go back to what the emperor said about these early Christians. See, they were all these kinds of people, they were expressing this, that, the next thing, but what they really wanted was money. You see, all they really wanted was money. Why? Because money is power and control to whoever has it. So I would have to question their motivation. Now, there's another problem, however, with this whole gold and silver in our business with respect to how it is to be administered. I mean, these are private individuals doing this right now, but in order to have a currency issue, officially it has to be done through the government. And since you're under the government of a legitimate, illegitimate rulership, I mean, how is this going to be done? So these people who are doing gold and silver and minting these coins and whatnot, they have to be doing it for either the purposes of speculation, all right, or they're doing it in order to help the Ummah preserve their wealth, you see. Now, I think you have both kinds of people out there. You have the traders who are doing it for speculation, and you have traders who are doing it to help people preserve their wealth. Now, this particular group, shall I name them? I mean, I know who you're talking about. They're Morabi Tum. I know them. I don't know them very well. But I know the symbols that they have placed on their dinars and on some of their institutions as icons. And these are symbols which are directly related to the cult esoteric circles. And I know this fellow that Ian Dallas, this so-called sheikh, he comes from a family which is connected with the Knight Templars, and he still promotes that particular stream of esoteric thought. So I cannot endorse their position just based on the use of the symbolism. Now I have, if you look at my website, my YouTube website, I have published a couple of lectures and have explained some of the symbolism there. And if you buy any of my books, you'll see, especially the new one coming out, I'm doing a final proofread on Cane's Creek right now. So within a few months, inshallah, it should be in print. And this is the book that explains the esoteric history of the Catholic, of what has become the Catholic Church. And you'll see in those books the explanations for the symbolism. If those symbols are being used on coins or on institutional icons that are supposed to be representing the Ummah of Muhammad, but they're using occult symbols from the Ummah of Iblis, then you're dealing with people who are either hypocrites or just plain stupid, which means that he cannot possibly be a legitimate sheikh. Because a legitimate sheikh would never use a symbol that represents the occult esoteric stream of the Cain's Creed, or the school of Iblis, to put it that way. So that's how I can answer that, without, you know, going into all of the details. That's pretty straightforward. Fitra explanation right there. You don't need to know much more than that. I mean, when Sister Sister Aynun came to me, what was it, 2 years ago, 3 years ago about this, and I looked at those symbols. I didn't know anything about Ian Dallas or Robbie Gordon. I didn't know anything about these people. I knew about the symbols, and I said, oh, well, if he's using those symbols, he cannot be authentic. This cannot be an authentic Islamic stream of illumination. There are authentic Islamic streams of esoteric knowledge. Yeah, they do exist, but that doesn't mean there's such a thing as a good magician or a good wizard, okay? Like you get from the Lord of the Rings. Don't mix the two, because they're not the same. They can't even compare. But when I saw those symbols, I knew that this was illegitimate, that this was inauthentic, just from the use of the symbols, or that the fellow was a moron and was being used as a pawn by Iblis and didn't know it. Now, those kinds of people are out there as well. Okay? So I hope that's enough.
Okay. Can we take two last questions? So we've already gone over time, so please keep it short. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah. My name is Azlan. I just want to get some comment or guidance from regarding Islamic banking, because for those who actually mostly believe that they have entered into Islamic banking, but in reality they are not. So to that extent, how this person would like to redeem their mistake or ignorance, because practically if you cancel a transaction, it may incur some losses, because the payment has been structured such a way that part of the payment is just to settle the interest of the sharing per se. So now that the person would like to, you know, redeem their ignorance or mistake, what would be your practical advice?
Can you explain that question to me?
If you go fallen into the hole, right? Islamic banking.
Yeah.
When you get out of the hole,
buy a taxi. Go do some honest work. You know, you fall into that hole. First thing, I'm not going to speak from a spiritual perspective, but this is just pure common sense. Any decent man who is trying to follow his fitra, no matter what his religious persuasion is, when he realizes that he's made a mistake, he will acknowledge it. Right? That is the first step. Okay, what did I do wrong? Okay, I'm driving. I'm lost!
how do I find my way back? You have to then ask for advice. You have to then ask for directions. If you don't know how to fix the mistake, that don't. I mean, if you're trying to build a house or a bridge and you know made a mistake, don't try to complete construction based on what you've already done wrong. You see. So sometimes I'll tell you what I do. I'll speak from my own personal experience here, then I'll hand it over to the Sheikh. Because this is a very important question that you ask. And sometimes the best way to answer such a question is to answer out of your own experience. I wrote a book that justified the Trinitarian position. And it took me 2 years to write the book. And this was before I became a Muslim. And before they threw me out of the Christian church for teaching the truth. I was still trying to justify this doctrine. That's how strong I was fighting my own vita. I'm 50 years old and I'm still trying to justify this thing that I was taught when I was this high. And I finally thought I justified it, and I did 300 pages and argument like a jurist, like a legal argument, okay? I became a real Romanist, canon law, doing it, you know. And then I became a Muslim. You know what that book is? I don't know. It's gone. I got rid of it. I was just about ready to have it printed, and I called